Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Dear friends, we gather here today to lay to rest Ronald James Sherman. We gather together as friends and as family to celebrate his life and to mourn his death. However, we do not mourn as those who have no hope, but as those who know the love of God in Jesus Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit. We Presbyterians, as part of the Church Universal, refer to this funeral service as a celebration of the resurrection, because even as we mourn the loss of one we love, we are bold to claim that nothing is able to separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ, not even death. And instead, we look forward to that day when, as Paul wrote to the church in Corinth, the trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised imperishable. We do not minimize death, but neither do we allow it more power than it deserves, because the power of death has been broken by the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
hear these words from Scripture. From Paul's letter to the church in Rome, when we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with Christ in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. And from Christ's words in the Gospel according to John, I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. And finally, from Paul's second letter to the church in Corinth, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our sorrows, so that we can comfort others in their sorrow with the consolation we have received from God. The scriptures are filled with all kinds of different writings, with stories, with prayers, with wisdom literature, and they're also filled with poetry. And one of the poems in scripture that is well known and one that brings great comfort to many people is known as the 23rd Psalm. You will find it printed in the program. And I invite you to join with me as we say this prayer, this poem in unison. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And would you please rise in body or in spirit, and let us join together singing hymn number 210. You'll find it in the blue hymnal that is in front of you in the pew. And let us pray. Eternal God, we acknowledge the uncertainty of our life on earth. We are given a mere handful of days, and our span of life seems nothing in your sight. All flesh is as grass, and all its beauty is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades, but your word will stand forever. In this is our hope, for you are our God. Even in the valley of the shadow of death, you are with us. O Lord, let us know our end and the number of our days, that we may learn how fleeting life is. Turn your ear to our cry and hear our prayer. Do not be silent at our tears, for we live as strangers before you, wandering pilgrims as all our ancestors were. But you are the same, and your years shall have no end. Amen. And at this time, I would like to invite Madeline and Todd to come forward and to share some memories on behalf of the family.
Hello. I am Madeline Sherman, and I am one of the three granddaughters of Ron and Sharon Sherman. I would first like to thank everyone for coming out today on this lovely morning to honor Ron Sharon, a man who is loved by many. By seeing how many have showed up today to honor him shows how many lives he has touched. Over the years, we didn't see him frequently, but in the times we did, those are memories that are never forgotten. The moments that stand out to me the most is when we'd visit my grandfather and grandmother at their cottage up north. We go out on the boat, and I just remember feeling the wind blow through my hair as I sat on my papa's lap while he drove the boat. He let me put my hands on the steering wheel with his over mine, making me feel like I was really steering the boat, when really, if I would have been steering, we would have crashed sooner than anyone could blink. That's just one of the many memories that were made. If I just sit and think of words that come to my head when I think of my grandfather, a few that come to mind are hardworking, unique, funny, and strong. He was a very strong person and fought a great battle in his last weeks to stay alive. He was inspiring in the way he went for things he wanted and was a strong-willed man that did things with passion. I came across a poem that I'm going to read aloud, and I think it's something that my grandfather would really agree with. "Weep not for me, even though I have gone into that gentle night. Grieve if you will, but not for long, upon my soul's sweet fight. I am at peace, my soul's at rest, there is no need for tears, for with your love I was so blessed for all these years. There is no pain, I suffer not, the fear is now all gone. Put now these things out of your thoughts, in your memory I live on. Remember not my fight for breath, remember not the strife, please do not dwell upon my death, but celebrate my life." The last part of the poem is the part I like the most. We should all honor and remember the things he accomplished and the long life he lives and celebrate it, because he may be gone, but his memory and the love we have for him will always live on in our hearts. Thank you.
What I'd like to do at this time is just say what she said. For those of you that don't know me, I'm Todd Sherman, Ron's youngest son. For those of you that do know me, and I guess to those that don't, I have a tendency to get emotional at times much lesser than this, such as sharing what I'm thankful for at Thanksgiving. So please bear with me if I go astray. But like, as Madeline did, I'd like to say thank you. Thank you all for being here today. Lots of familiar faces, many that I haven't seen in a long time. And while I tried to come up with something to say today that would weave together so many different aspects about what I wanted to share about my dad, about my life, Sharon, and my brother, it was difficult to try to get all these things to blend together because it was just such a big story to try to tell. So all that said, it's been a while since my dad's passing, but it's given me some time to think. And I would constantly come up with little anecdotes, memories, just little remembrances about my father and growing up. The downside is, I guess I didn't take the time to write some of those things down. I wish I did, but nonetheless, while I might not remember all those thoughts, I have over the past 8 or so weeks, I've thought about my father often. And frankly, I was surprised by how often I thought of him. Sometimes I questioned myself if I thought about him as much when he was still with us. And maybe I just didn't take the time to take it in or to take action on it. Numerous times I'd be at work and have an architectural question, and the first thing that pops into my mind is ask Dad. It surprised me how often and how easily I came to that thought that I would want to know how deep to make a truck deck. Or another example is I would be assigned a new work assignment at work, and I would want to brag to my dad. I miss my dad. So who was Ron Sherman? He was a devoted husband. He was a father. He was an architect and an entrepreneur. He was a hunter, a fisherman, a golfer, a skier, and a friend to many. He always had a plan. He always had a project. He was always working on making something better than what it was. That included, he designed 3 of his own homes, built them usually by himself, or he would have my brother and I help him demolish what was there prior. All of his other homes he renovated. I would guess that, I know he lived in a couple apartments over the time, I guess he would have renovated those too if they would have let him. His love and devotion to Sharon was beyond measure. It was certainly an example for me to see how deeply he loved Sharon and his commitment to her. And it was just always fun to see how they would carry on, kind of like a couple of high school sweethearts. My brother and I, we certainly had our antics that didn't make the fathering part of my father's life so easy, but he was usually there to bail us out. I was going to get into some memories in a little bit, but I guess something that would tie into this is there was a time shortly after my dad and Sharon wed, my father lived on Green Lake, beautiful home, one of the homes that he built. And the two of them moved into Sharon's condo, one of the places he renovated. And why in the world he let me stay in that house? I don't know, like 22 years old or so. It was a really cool place to live on your own. Over a couple of days, I would come home and I was living the lake life, and I would get the Weber out, cook up some really nice dinner. Probably like 2-3 days later, I was gonna cook again. So what do? Scoop up the ashes, put them in a paper bag, set them down on the deck. The next morning, I woke up, walked out the door onto the deck, and almost fell through a hole. Probably about the size of this table up here. Those ashes that had sat in that Weber, you know, for 2-3 days, they lit the place afire. The neighbor put the fire out, thankfully. in the middle of the night. But, you know, I was prepared for the wrath of my dad. And I don't know why he didn't, but he just fixed the hole. Excuse me. Ron Sherman was an architect down to the bone. His passion for the profession drove him to success. And successful he was. Many of the people in this room I know are business associates, clients, former employees, all of who I've had the pleasure of being part of that, having worked with my dad in his firm. And I think that's, I talked to some of you about, hopefully some other stories will come out about how my father's work was an integral part of his life, and that the line between family, client, colleague was very blurred, and that's part of what I just grew up in. I was fortunate to work with my dad for those reasons, not just for the practical experience, but for the camaraderie of family, friends, and clients alike. My dad would always proudly introduce me to his business associates, and they in turn would treat me as a colleague and friend right back. I have many fond memories of times with my dad, camping on the Manistee River. Even that came up today in some of the greetings this morning. Hunting. I remember going on hunting trips, and we would go up north, and we would have to literally shovel off an area of field so that we could pitch a tent and put a propane heater in it. Why we did that, I don't know. But boy, was that fun. When we started doing that, I was too young to hunt. I'm not quite sure why he brought me along, other than just he just wanted me to be there. I just recall coming back to camp. My dad would help us set up, me and my brother, blinds in the woods, and he would get up super early in the morning, and he would drop us off at each one of our spots, and then at the end of the day he'd come back and collect us, or I would give up and just walk back to the tent myself, and I would always have snow and leaves up and down my back, and they're like, "What were you doing?" I said, "Well, I slept." Another favorite memory of mine is our ski trips to Colorado. We'd stay on condos right on the slopes. You'd literally just, you'd walk out the door, put your skis on, and ski right down to the first lift. At the end of the day, you'd put your skis right there at the front door, take a couple more steps, and you'd be in the jacuzzi that was right underneath the chairlift. It was a memory I'll never forget. However, there was one of those trips that my father got hurt. I don't quite remember. I think he got either jabbed with a ski pole or twisted his knee up, but he wound up in the hospital. And it wasn't anything serious, but they gave him some painkillers, and I've never seen my dad so loopy in my life. Fishing trips to White Lake in Canada. I think probably the best meal I've ever had in my life. A shore lunch with fresh walleye, caught minutes before it was cooked, potatoes, all cooked by a guide who just handed you a plate with just piles of fresh fish. Best meals I've ever had. Hockey. I'm forever grateful that my father introduced me to the game of hockey. I was very young, I don't know, 5, 6, and I remember measuring how well I did by just telling him how many times I fell down or didn't in any particular day. It's a game I still play to this day. I was fortunate to be able to spend some time with my dad in the weeks before he passed. We were able to have talks that perhaps we should have had long before. I learned a few things about my dad in these conversations, and some of those I promised not to share. These talks also reminded me that he wasn't just a dad. He was a person of his own. It's easy, too easy sometimes, to forget that your parents are people too. In these talks, I learned of the boy he once was, the relationships that he had with his own mother and father, and the young man looking to make his own way in the world. I learned of his hopes, his dreams, his demons, and regrets. Naturally, as any parent would, he expressed regrets about not being the father that he wished he could have been. I know this troubled him deeply for the tears that he shed when he said that. I hope I eased some of his regret by telling him that I wouldn't have changed a thing. I told him that everything he is, did, or does has had an impact on me and has brought me and my life to where it is today. I have a loving wife of 18 years, two beautiful, brilliant, and talented daughters. I have a beautiful home and an architectural career of my own. I told him that his success is measured by how all of life's events leading up to this moment. I told him that I measure my success by that of my daughters, which is really a culmination of all things past. I told him I wouldn't change a thing. I think he heard me, I hope. So I say thank you, Dad, for the lessons you taught me, for the values you instilled in me. And for telling me you're proud of me. I love you. Thank you.
Thank you, Todd.
Thank you.
this point, I'd like to invite Lisa Manganiello to come forward for a reading of Ecclesiastes. And as Lisa is coming up, Todd, I want you to know that you said you hoped your dad heard you. I saw him the next day, and he heard you. So I think it's important to know those things. Come on up, Lisa. And as we prepare to turn to Scripture, let us pray. Oh, eternal God, your love for us is everlasting. You alone can turn the shadow of death into the brightness of the morning light. Help us to turn to you with believing hearts. In the stillness of this hour, speak to us of eternal things, so that hearing the promises in Scripture, we may have hope and be lifted above our distress into the peace of your presence, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
For everything, there is a season, a time for every activity under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to harvest, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build up, a time to cry and a time to laugh, a time to grieve and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather stones, a time to embrace and a time to turn away, a time to search and a time to quit searching, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be quiet and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace. What do people really get for all their hard work? I've seen the burden God has placed on us all. Yet God has made everything beautiful for its own time. He has planted eternity in the human heart. But even so, people cannot see the whole scope of God's work from beginning to end. So I concluded there is nothing better than to be happy and enjoy ourselves as long as we can. And people should eat and drink and enjoy the fruits of their labor, for these are gifts from God. And I know that whatever God does is final. Nothing can be added to it or taken from it. God's purpose is that people should hear him.
Our gospel reading this morning, or this afternoon, excuse me, it comes from the gospel according to John in the 14th chapter, verses 1 through 6, and continuing with 25 through 27. So let us attend to God's word for us this afternoon. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. All this I have spoken while still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So we have heard a bit from Todd and from Madeline about Ron. about the man he was and the life he led. If you've read his obituary on the back of the program, you may learn a bit more. The Ron I knew was only the Ron of the last few years. Ecclesiastes tells us there's a time to be born and a time to die, and there's an awful lot that happens in between those things. Things that Ecclesiastes talks about, things that we hear about from Ron's life. Ron lived a rich, full life, filled with lots of wonderful things and filled with some hard things too, as every life is. I didn't know Ron when he was golfing and fishing and hunting. I knew Ron mostly after he had gotten ill. I remember talking to Ron in the hospital where he was suffering because of an aneurysm in his heart. He said his ticker had become a ticking bomb. Didn't know when it would give out. And often when people are aging or are facing death, their true character tends to come through. We sometimes say their filters come down. We've all known people who, as they age, get difficult, shall we say. People who can be downright cruel in what they say and do. But not Ron. As Ron's character came through, I got to know a man who was loving and gentle and caring. He was a man who still told stories and loved to laugh. I remember visiting at the house over in Crooked Tree, and Ron would be lying in his chair, his lounge chair that they had put in, often looking out the window, often listening to beautiful music. And in those last days, he was in a lot of pain, but he still laughed. He still told stories. A lot of Ron's character was very evident in his last few years and his last few weeks. And the other thing about Ron that was very evident was his faith. Now, I don't know if it's just because I'm a pastor and people like to look pious in front of pastors. That's not what I saw in Ron, though. Ron had a deep and genuine faith, and I don't know all the history of that. But his faith was strong. And Ron knew where he was going. In those last days, even more than that, he was ready. He was tired of the pain, he was tired of the fight, and he was ready to go home. The only thing that kept him from doing so was his love of Sharon and his love for all of you. He was not afraid to die because he knew where he was going. He understood this passage that we read this afternoon, where Jesus says, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me." He understood what Jesus meant when he said, "My Father's house has many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you I go to prepare a place for you?" Ron understood that because Ron spent his life preparing places for other people. That was his career. That's what an architect does. They find out somebody's needs, they find out what kind of person they are, and then they design a place for them. A place where they can do what they're meant to do, whether it is a home, whether it is a business. Jesus is that architect that has designed a place for Ron. And it's one of the reasons Jesus says, "In my Father's house there are many rooms." Part of it is saying that, yeah, there's a lot of space there. There's room for everybody. There are many rooms in that sense, but I think Jesus is saying there are many different rooms because Jesus prepares a place for each of us. Not a one-size-fits-all, not a prefab home, but one designed just for us. He has a place designed just for Ron. And I don't know what that place is like. Maybe it's on a golf course. Maybe there's a lake nearby or a stream to fish in. Maybe there's music playing. I don't know what Ron's place is like, but I know it's right for him because Jesus has prepared it for him. An architect knows how to get to know the person they're designing for and to build just the right place, and Jesus does that. But unlike an architect, Jesus doesn't build a place for us and then leave us to it. Jesus builds a place for us to be with him. Jesus says that, made this place so that you can be where I am. Jesus has made a place for Ron so that Ron can be with him. And that is the invitation for us all. That the architect who knows us, who loves us, who made us, invites us to get to know him and to prepare to move in with him as this life comes to an end. Ron is in a great place that is made just for him. But we are still here. And if you knew and loved Ron, you miss him. You kind of wish he was back here instead of there. Right? And it is okay for us to mourn. It's okay for us to cry. It's okay to feel sad. Jesus cried at the tomb of his friend Lazarus. And weeping is part of what shows the love that we have for one another. We mourn, but we do not mourn as those who have no hope. And so we not only mourn, but we also share our stories, we share our tears, and we share our laughter. We celebrate Ron's life, and we keep him alive in our memories. But we don't keep him alive just in our memories. We keep him alive knowing that he lives really and truly in a place just prepared for him with the Lord he loved. And so as we bid Ron goodbye, let us hear again Jesus' words, where he says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled, and neither let them be afraid. But instead know the peace that Jesus leaves with us, the peace that comes from knowing him and having his Spirit. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen." That faith that Ron knew, that faith that gives us hope even in the face of death, is one we affirm in the words of the Apostles' Creed. So I invite you, if you will, to rise in body or in spirit and join together as we recite this affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. And let us pray. O God, before whom generations rise and pass away, we praise you for all your servants who, having lived this life in faith, now live eternally with you. And especially we thank you for your servant, Ron, whose baptism is now complete in death. We praise you for the gift of his life, for all in him that was good and kind and faithful, for the grace you gave him that kindled in him the love of your dear name and enabled him to serve you faithfully. We thank you that for him death is past and pain ended, and that he has now entered the joy you have prepared through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
Scripture reminds us that weeping may last for a night, but joy comes in the morning. And so we close with a hymn that speaks of that joy, and I invite you to rise in body or spirit, and let us sing together our closing hymn, number 464, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. are immortal, the creator and maker of all. We are mortal, formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return. This you ordained when you created us, saying you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to your servants with all your saints, where there is neither pain nor sorrow nor sighing, but life everlasting. Holy God, by your creative power you gave us life, and in your redeeming love you gave us new life in Christ. We commend Ron to your merciful care in the faith of Christ our Lord, who died and rose again to save us, and who now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And friends, as we prepare to leave this place, Sharon and the family invite you to join them at Birchwood Farm for a reception. If you need directions, there are little cards like this that you will find to your left as you are exiting the sanctuary. And as we go, let us go with God's blessing. May the peace of God, which passes understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit remain with you always. Amen. Thank you.